Sometimes there are down moments in one's professional or work life when one doesn't feel fully motivated to perform his best in the workplace. But prolonged and sustained underperformance is another thing. What's concerning is chronic underperformance can hit many employees and workplaces. And our next guest, Ateneo de Manila University Assistant Professor Jairo Trevino, calls this quiet quitting or unspoken resignation. Let's tackle quiet quitting now. Welcome to the program, Professor Trevino.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. Glad to be with you this afternoon.
Good to have you here on such an interesting topic. Now, quiet quitting, some sort of phenomenon happening in the workplace in many organizations these days. It is hitting productivity and professional performance in so many immense ways. Tell us first what it is and how different is it from an actual resignation?
Actually, Stanley, quiet quitting is a mislabeled term because when it trended in social media last year, employees are not necessarily leaving the organization.
Yeah.
But in terms of delivery of output, they are just giving the bare minimum, meaning they are not going above and beyond expectations.
Okay, so it's practically like living with zombies around the office. Now, Professor, what are the signs of quiet quitting and what must one or both, in fact, individuals or even organizations look out for to see if one might be inflicted without even knowing it?
When I was looking into this particular term, I saw that this became a narrative of the Great Resignation, which hit the United States, UK, and some parts of Asia. Mm. Now, quiet quitting is not actually new. In fact, the term is new because it resonated to a lot of millennials and Gen Z in TikTok. But in terms of organizational behavior studies, yeah, this has been happening already. And there's no one singular cause why one employee will quit quietly. And a lot of reasons would be the environment, the culture, and probably in the Milieu Insight study, it was stated that low salary can be a big factor for employees with quiet.
Okay, and what are the signs? You already mentioned underproductivity or low productivity. Is there anything else that, you know, that is unique or a unique attribute to this phenomenon?
In terms of the study, there's no particular factors yet because we have yet to see published studies from management scholars. But number one, in terms of delivery for the 40 work hours in the Philippines, they just do that 40 hours. They don't go beyond that particular number of working hours.
Okay, so they are not extra milers. You mentioned a while ago that this phenomenon has hit, well, largely the US and the UK. How prevalent is it here in the Philippines?
We're not really looking into quiet quitting in the Philippines because I don't think we have that particular culture, but a few can engage in quiet quitting. For example, culture is a very big factor since in Japan, wherein they don't just work hard, but they extremely work hard, quiet quitting will not be prevalent. In fact, in China, when it started sometime around 2021 through the Lying Flat Movement and the they call it Ting Tang, this even affected, for example, some people to resonate with quiet quitting.
Okay, is it possible that in the Philippines, this is a function of economics because, you know, you need that income, you need that salary, so you continue working? Perhaps the reason why it is not as obvious in a lot of Filipino workers as compared to those in the West.
Agree, economic factors can be one of the things why we hold on to one particular job. In fact, for the Great Resignation, we thought that it will not happen in the Philippines, but when we started to relax our quarantine in the Philippines, we started to see some trends also, specifically in Metro Manila.
Okay, so is that a light bulb moment, the fact that a lot of people realize that before the pandemic, there was no work-life balance?
More of self-preservation. We need to realize now that mental health is really something that we need to prioritize because for someone who is not a quiet quitter, the idea of work-life balance may not be obvious because for them, work is life. But there would be a lot of consequences for people who are doing quiet quitting because, number one, they can be perceived as someone who is lazy and right. potentially they can be unreliable in the workplace and disengaged in terms of that connection to their work.
Okay, and what about the impact to the company or the organization? How are organizations dealing with this?
It will surely have a huge impact because, like what you've said earlier, productivity will be affected. Anything can be measured, can be done. But for quiet quitting, these are soft factors that can really affect productivity. So probably for organizations, we need to have that consultative method or dialogue with our employees in order to really go into the root cause of why some employees are quitting quietly.
And isn't that already a practice of a lot of organizations, especially in this day and age where you have a younger workforce with so many options available to them? How are organizations coping?
The hustle culture has also somehow led us to this particular phenomenon. I thought it was a generational gap. For example, Gen Z, who are now included in the workplace, are the more vocal when it comes to quiet quitting. But apparently, even millennials, Gen X and Gen Y, are starting to go through this particular phenomenon. So we need to consider that the traditional method will no longer work. If we're looking into an environment which is still patterned after the traditional workforce, we need to see that work culture is somehow evolving. That's why there are arrangements for hybrid work, for example, that can answer quiet quitting.
Okay, and are organizations now aware that they have to offer more than just salaries in terms of benefits and even facilities or even opportunities to communicate with employees about productivity, about career paths and directions? Because really, quiet quitting can also be a result of the fact that an employee does not see any future in that organization.
I completely agree with you on that one, Stanley. Empathy is something that we don't see sometimes in organizations. They're just after the output. As long as you deliver, for example, sales, you are okay. But what if you get sick? What if suddenly you have these issues when it comes to mental health? How are we being supported? So a lot of HR interventions can be done. Coaching and mentoring can help. And this can be done outside of the work hours to ensure that employees feel that they are also supported.
Okay, and on the part of employees, no, we all have good days and bad days at work. Sometimes we feel unmotivated, but it is important that we really snap out of it as soon as possible. Now, the danger, though, lies if the feeling is lingering or chronic. How and where can one seek help, perhaps? What can you suggest?
Agree, if you no longer feel as excited compared to your first day, your day one at work, there has to be some realignment in terms of purpose. Probably you can seek a conversation with your boss, your supervisor, or with a friend who you can fully trust to discuss these important issues. Because when you leave this to yourself alone, probably we can be misguided. And at the spur of the moment, because emotions are high, you can decide to not even quiet quit, but leave the organization.
And on the part of the organization, is it wise for it to actually reach out to people and ask?
It's very important for them to come up with some dialogue because this, for example, feedback surveys are being conducted to remain the anonymous feature of the employee so that their status in the organization will not be jeopardized.
All right, Professor Jairo Trevino, thank you so much for this interesting discussion on quiet quitting and productivity. We do hope to have more of these conversations in the future. Have a good day.
Have a good day. Thank you, Stanley.